love to ride, and we love the brotherhood, because that's what it's about, our brotherhood. And, you know, I live every day like it's my last, because one day I'm going to be right. Number one, we're a double outlaw. We ride motorcycles, and plus we're black. And we're going to get a double whammy. You can take the colors off, but you're still going to be an outlaw in America. It's not about trying to make $1 million. It's not about trying to get out here and conquer the world. It's about one-on-one, brotherhood. That's what it is, our brotherhood, wheels of soul, getting down to the soul.
After KYW3's Bruce Hamilton takes you inside the world of the Wheels of Soul.
Life under the L is rough and gritty, a patchwork of shadow, noise, and crime. These are store owners who protect their business in this neighborhood. And these are the guys who make it their business to protect the neighborhood.
You'd never guess it by the looks of things, but the brotherhood on this block begins right here with the Wheels of Soul, a motorcycle club.
I'm not your typical American. Tell me who's is who's. Tell me who was on the microphone. I'm all the other Kobe's. I propose I would like a bone to edge off the dreads. I'm a like Stuart Spock, the drone, political and mystical. I really hope you like my points. Aim at a target like a rock, not a shot. Hello, can you hear me now, G? The typical American kid, that ain't me. Neither is Odie.
Fucking city is hard as a mother. You know, to live on the streets of Philadelphia is hard. Your life is in your hands every day, every second of the day.
This is inner city club. We're right in the heart of the ghetto. I mean, we're right in the middle of, we're right in the thick of it, you know? So it's different problems and different things. That's why we're addressing problems that other clubs ain't got, you know, in the Midwest or in some Iowa or South of North Dakota or Missouri.
I guess everybody has a formulated opinion about a motorcycle gang. You see stories on TV or you heard different urban legends of motorcycle gangs.
Wheels of Soul is not a gang, it's a club. But some people always consider bikers gang when they see a bunch of people together. But we're not about that. We're not about no violence or nothing like that.
We're not a gang. We're a motorcycle club. And you gotta have a job. You know what I mean? Wheels of Soul can't feed your family. You have to feed your family. You know what I mean? We'd rather have working people here than non-working people.
The stigma as far as being what they think we are, we're not. We're a bunch of good guys out here trying to ride, take care of the neighborhood, and just survive.
Most of the people in our club have jobs or they have companies. We got everything from roofers here to plumbers to electricians. And it takes all that. I mean, people with nothing and got no skills ain't doing nobody no good, yeah? And it definitely takes some money to be keeping your nice-looking Harley together.
Our biker lifestyle is just like your lifestyle at home. You have to have a mother, you have a father, you have a sister and a brother. We all have to get along in this one house. So when you come to me and you say to me, hey, brother, how can you get along with this motorcycle club? How can you get along with that motorcycle? I just say, man, I give you what you give me back.
Even if I get pulled over by a police officer, the first thing they want to say is, you got any weapons or drugs on you? There's your stereotype right there. They look at you like you're mean, evil, back in the 60s, drugged out, wanting to rape and pillage people. I mean, it's not like that anymore. I mean, we have our own ways of life, and that's my life.
casket was used when they cremated and they had to destroy it, so they had holes in it. So when I told them what I wanted to use it for a motorcycle, he said, if I bring them pictures of it, I could have the casket for free. So that's it. We just took a foot and something out of it to send it over to Wheel Wells, and that's it. In the back there, I put the wheelie bars on it, because when it pops, it can roll on the wheelie bars, but the camera ain't on it. And that's the wheelie bars.
And these brothers, I'll do anything for them. Hear me? Anything. And they'll do anything for me, man. Because I done had some hard times, man. I've been in prison, done a lot of shit. And they were always there for me. They never turned their back on me.
For this brotherhood is concerned, I don't think I could even nowhere in this world find a better union, okay, amongst a bunch of brothers that actually care about their communities. And as you visit with us, you know, on a day-to-day basis, you'll find out every chapter that we have across the country, that's what it's all about. We take care of the community.
Blood families don't have the love that we have for each other. And their blood, well, blood only means that you're related, but, you know, I mean, you don't have to be blood to be family. We are a family, you know what I'm saying? And we will die for each other. Don't get it messed up.
It's about brotherhood, you know what I mean? A lot of people lost that. You see it day to day, man. They're about that dower, or they're killing their own brothers off because they know too much, or any of that kind of mess, man. And you know, that ain't brotherhood, man. You know, I mean, sure as hell ain't that to me.
This biker lifestyle is somewhat that's for the chosen, because you've got to have, like this cigarette, certain taste in your mouth for it. You understand what I'm saying?
This is our area, and we said this is where we want to be, and that's the best way to go. You control your own neighborhood, that you have to control the situation. But if it's looking bad and being tore up, it's because you're letting it be that way. You can't blame it on nobody else if you get in and do the best you can yourself.
One thing we don't do with the community, we don't take from the community, we give. We wouldn't even be in existence, and we realize this, for some of these citizens around here.
My working relationship with them is fine with the different members. We talk, we laugh, we joke, and some of the advice is good advice as far as community contact with different things that's going on in the community.
I was one of the first brothers in the club that became an amputee. And there's a shop over in Jersey, a young man named Nick. They had never dealt with, say, for as a motorcycle, how would you deal with someone that's an amputee? Because my left leg is gone, you know, well, below the knee. I told him in the hospital, you know, gangrene is set in, the whole shebang. I said, look, cut the sucker off, let me out of here so I can go see my bike, because I hadn't seen my bike for like 3 months. I was in the hospital.
I'm the cat they're never gonna forget, you know? When they're 50 years old, they're gonna remember the first tattoo.
Pop told me when I was younger, said, I'm gonna teach you how to, rest of your life, you will never have to work. I said, how you do that? Just find out what you love to do, and you would do it for free, for nothing. And find out how you can make a living from doing that. So, you know, my heart, I love doing it. I would do it for nothing, you know? It's luckily I get paid for it, so it's like, it'll not work for me, you know.
Well, before they got here, I think it was a lot worse here. Yeah. And they got in here and the block cleaned up a lot. You know, and they put their pretty bikes out here, work on them. They're always doing something constructive, you know, positive.
Yeah, they have a preconceived notion that we're just like out here just like beating up people. It ain't about that. It's about riding your motorcycle. And that's what I'm about.
All right, everybody, have your attention up here. This is a band that'll snap your head back like a pet suspension, leaving you with enough change for a Whopper with cheese. Give it up for Dal Ray and the Blues Outlaws.
But we don't see no color in our club, you know what I mean? At all. We don't see no color. Everybody's a man, you know what I mean? You come in as a man. They welcome me in this club as a man. Not as black or white, Puerto Rican, whatever. You know what I'm saying? We just all men together and living one lifestyle, just riding our motorcycles and enjoying ourselves, enjoying our brotherhood. That's what it's all about.
Make it, we don't care if he's green. If he's worthy of wearing Wheels of Soul color, then he's as black as any of us.
You know, I don't care if you're purple, green, white, yellow, it don't mean shit. The whole thing comes down to, as long as you got this ride on, as long as you're part of this club, man, that's what matters.
I don't see color. So that to them to address me, they can say, well, we can talk to you, but we ain't got nothing to say to your brother. Which means I ain't got nothing to say to them. Have a nice day.
I don't even think about, you know, the color of the guy I'm riding next to, thinking about whether he's got my back or not.
Enough of this black and white thing. Enough of this brown and yellow thing. See us? We're all blackers. We're all under the same blackers, brother. Come on now. When you see a brother, man, just because he don't wear the same rags that you wear, understand him. He might be the bailiff when you go to jail. Watch yourself.
We make these colors. These colors don't make us. I'm Roadrunner with them or without them. I'm Hal Stevenson with them or without them. I will hurt you with them or without them if you violate me or my people or whatever I love.
As long as I got two wheels, if I get too old and that don't work, I'll get three. You know, I'll keep going, but it's in my blood to do this, and for my son's sake, because he was getting ready to come back into the club with me. And unfortunately, like I said, he was killed. So as a one percenter or outlaw or whatever, first of all, I'm a man. Second of all, I'm a father.
We all came from good families. It's just something went wrong down the line.
This biker lifestyle, not for everyone. But if you don't like it, try to understand it. Don't hate it.
Most people think that Wheels of Soul are just strictly black, but that is falsism, all right? We have a rainbow coalition, as you can see around here, all right? White, black, Chicano, Puerto Rican, you name it, Indian, they all make up the Wheels of Soul. So we're, again, in doing and saying the things that we do, we try to change our image by all of us being working people, all right? First of all, in order to come in the Wheels of Soul, you have to be 18, you understand? And you also have to have a job. As much as people would like to say, we don't sell drugs, all right? We don't steal bikes, all right? That's not the MO in which we're trying to go through the next millennium in.
And I wouldn't give this up for nothing in the world. You know, I just wish my son had been here to enjoy with me. You know what I mean? Because we were gonna do this together. But the rain, the mud, as you see, the mud, you know? I wouldn't exchange this for nothing. I mean, all the things I've been through in my 53 years of life, this is it for me. You know what I mean? This is it. And you're interviewing me again, ain't you? Yes, you are. But it's okay, though.
Where did you get chocolate from? Give me a piece. Give me a piece. Stop. Whoa.
All right, now what do you all want?
Napkin.
Okay, well we gotta have something. You can get a piece of fruit, some water, some juice, and take it back upstairs. Taylor, watch the map.
The map is in China.
Huh? This is the map that shows you China.
China.
This is a piece Dolores did. She worked in Pascal. And she doesn't think she's an artist, but she is. She's a hell of an artist. And, here's a piece of, this is Joe Tipperino. This was a portrait Joe did of me up in Soho. This is after a night of, we were doing some serious drinking. This is my work here. I work mostly in steel and wood. It's has a tribal feel, and it's abstract. That music influences me a lot. You can feel the rhythms.
Jerome has such a magnetic personality. He's so personable and charming. When my family met him, I guess they probably knew he was a biker right off. But he was just, generally, he got along with them. I mean, he could talk on anything, politics, religion, poetry, art.
His house is so pretty, I was scared to walk up to the door, man. These motherfuckers gonna call the cops on us, man. I said, this is the first place these people see me coming up there.
Oh, man.
What the hell is he doing coming up to my door out here? We getting robbed. Call the police.
It's a microcosm of society. It's just people look a little different, dress a little different, and their hobby is a little different. To give you another example, my father and mother belonged to a yacht club in Annapolis, Maryland, a black yacht club, and they had their opening day ceremonies. And they had the colors that they wore, you know, the traditional boating colors, you know, the blue and white or something very neutral and very bland, just like, you know, bikers have their color, which is blue and black, blue jeans, black t-shirt, leather, whatever. And they have their opening day little, you know, their 1%ers have to be up, I think, April 26th. All bikes are supposed to be up May 1st. The opening of boating season, I believe, is sometime in May. So, I mean, it's really just the same. You know, what's the real difference between someone who drives a yacht or you drive a motorcycle? One's less threatening, though. I'll give you that.
We were young, man. We were in our 20s and stuff. Matter of fact, I had to be around 18. 18, Cliff was about 20-something.
Oh, good,
man. And the cop came up and started giving us some shit. And he pulled his gun out on us. And one of the guys took the gun from him. And he got in his car and hauled ass and asked for backup. By that time, we were all gone. And so we still had the cop's gun. So I didn't want the cop's gun or nothing, you know. Nobody else wanted the cop's gun. So Cliff told his father. He says, you know all the cops in this area. To give him back the gun. You know, so he took the gun back to the cops. Cops thanked him for bringing the gun back and shit. And that was the end of that. That was back in the 60s on Wheels. Wheels of Soul, the only mixed club in the country flying a 1% patch. We started flying this patch in 1974. We ain't never took it off. We earned this patch. Wheels of Soul started. I joined the club in 67, got my colors in 68. Got my diamond in 74. And it's gonna be buried with me in my coffin.
Well, at least there's not too many clubs that's dumb enough to be putting that 1% patch on if they're not a 1% club, because that's something that they will be stepped to about and right fast and in a hurry. Because
as far as we're concerned.
Definitely as far as we're concerned, as far as any other club that has 1% is in. I don't know nobody in 1% club that's going to be having some moron running around with the patch on and don't know what it's about. He's definitely going to find out real quick.
You have just met a member of an outlaw motorcycle club. God forgive, but we don't.
So when people do me good, I treat them well. When they do me bad, we can't talk about that.
If I was doing something, I'd be worried about that fucking shit. I ain't doing that. I ain't planning on doing no fucking shit. So, you know, they can think what they want to think. They're going to think it anyway, Cliff.
You're right.
They're going to think it.
Convince me.
You know, I ain't got to convince you. I got to convince a jury.
I tell you, my name is Juan Diaz.
There's no way to tell a difference between what one 1% or gang club looks like and what another 1% or gang club looks like. They all look alike. The same colors, the same attitudes, except some guys are good guys and some guys aren't. The Wheels are the good guys.
But a 1%er is one of the baddest outlaws that there is alive today in these 1%er clubs. And to be racially mixed, I mean, you look at it. You look at it from your point of view. I got white, Puerto Rican, black, everyone in there mixed in an outlaw club. You got other clubs out there that are racism. I'm gonna stop that question. I don't wanna go any further on that one.
I've been in prison now almost 11 years, and I tell you what, there's family members that don't stick with their loved ones or their brothers or whatever while they're doing time. And the Wolves have been there with me every step of the way. It's a brotherhood, you know. It's white, brown, black, it don't matter. When you're wearing Wolves colors is of no consequence, and it's unfortunate that there are clubs out in the country and out in the world that their bylaws stipulate that you got to be white just to prospect and just to fly their colors, and they're missing out on something real special.
They've become like Nazis in 1935, man, you know, part of the party, you know. They've become part so rigid that they've become more ridiculous than the people they were trying to rebel against. They forgot about the fun of biking, sitting down, partying, and bullshitting with brothers.
When you was black, especially as black as some of us are, we could take off our colors all we want. I still go down New Jersey Turnpike, and you could be asking for a whole bunch of shit without doing a darn thing.
Are you afraid to go in this area because, say, this biker club is here, that biker club there? The hell with that, man. I ride right through the area. Because the bottom line is, when I stop and I look at things, I say it like this. I'm in your bar, and you want me to leave, I got no fucking problem. Pay me for my drink, and I'm out the fucking door. You ain't got to put your hands on me, you ain't got to act tough with me. Because see me, I'm tough enough. I'm tough enough. Because if I want to stay there and drink that beer, I'll take the consequences of that beer.
Brother, let me tell you, we step anywhere we want to step. Anywhere, you hear me? And I'm telling you, we step anywhere we feel like stepping.
We're not doing nothing that no other family do. We just ride motorcycles.
I've seen outlaw clubs, you know, 1%er clubs, man. They're heavies, a lot of heavies. And the only time you see them on their bikes is on a mandatory run when they're made to ride. You know, they've forgotten how, you know, fun it is just to get together with a brother and take a ride. Drugs, man, took a terrible toll on clubs. It destroyed some clubs in one way where the clubs broke up, and destroyed clubs the other way where they've gotten to such heavy shit where they can't even trust each other.
At least here, you know what you're dealing with. You know who's around you, man. You know what I'm saying? You know who, where the love's at and who your brothers are and everything else. And you know, the respect is here. As far as anybody else who can't understand that shit, either two things you can do, man. Either walk away or stand up. But either way, you're gonna get dealt with it.
Sometimes our lifestyle catches up with us, you know? And when it catches up with us big. But that's the way we are, you know? And we gotta leave here. That's why we shake each other's hands, because sometimes we might not see each other again. You know, that's why we kiss each other, because we might not see each other the next time around. It might be that when you pull off, your brother pulls off on his bike, that might be the last time you see him.
lot of people can't be a Wheels of Soul. A lot of people can't handle it, man.
Yeah, we had to fuck up the neighbors about it, dog. We better fuck up.
Ray shot the dog. Who was it?
They shot the dog.
The dog's still alive.
Damn, the dog's still alive.
They shot seven,
the
dog seven times, man.
Shot the dog. Yeah.
They shot the dog.
He shot it, and
we fucking kicked their ass. We kicked their ass.
And the dog's still here, man.
The dog's still.
He don't look like nothing's wrong with him.
The junkies who shot the dog. That's a different story.
When they see the dog, man, they said, all you gotta say, badger, and them motherfuckers, they get on point.
Yeah, badger, man, that's a bad
dog. That's a bad dog. It's a bad dog. It's a part of us.
But every dog sees his day.
We kicked the whole neighborhood's ass about that dog.
Tore that neighborhood apart, man.
That was a good time, man. Good times.
But you know what? That neighborhood there needed to be straightened out because, like, we were, like, fucking, the only people in there that was doing right. Yeah. The junkies was on one corner and the drug dealers on the other corner.
Every summer, man. You had to clear all them guys out. There'd be a whole new regime up in there every summer, and every summer you'd have to clear them right back out.
But they knew what the deal was.
We took you up there right now, and they didn't know you. And then you people on the block, they'd probably stick a gun in your face.
They'd take the cameras.
They'd take the cameras.
Yeah, definitely.
These guys are not bullies. That's one thing that's so, they look tough. They are tough. They look mean. They scare people. You can hear the clicks of the door locks as cars are coming under the L there, and they don't know where they are, and they see that crew of motorcycles and guys in leather. They wouldn't do a thing. They, you know, that's the thing. You would literally trust your grandmother with these guys. And I've been there in the clubhouse when a phone call has come in from literally a little old lady who's gotten off at the L, and she wants somebody to walk her home because it's dark, and you know, a wheel was dispatched to do that. Sounds like a Boy Scout, is a Boy Scout, but isn't. Not by a long shot.
Well, in this area here, we try to keep the neighborhood pretty clean, try to keep the drug dealers away. Make it safe for the elderly, people to walk, come and go as they please. That's the main thing about that.
What we're interested in is just from 61st to 62nd, and market right now. We just want to, you know, get our whole block and do it the best we can. You know, that's why we got the ATM and all for our neighbors and people saying you can't have an ATM down here. You can do anything you need to do like anybody else. The people want things and they need them, and they're not just going to tear up everything just because they're in a particular neighborhood.
The Wheels of Souls have been a good neighbor. They support the neighborhood in every way they can and all the functions that they may have. And the women in the neighborhood feel a lot better with them around. There's always an escort if a woman needs it late at night. And a couple of times people have wanted to take some of my stuff because I put it out on the sidewalk like a flea market, and they've kept them from doing that by policing the area. So I'm very fortunate in having them around.
They try to prevent people from congregating around the corners and rowdy crowds, and they help clean up the community, and they have different events. I see them working with children and kids around the community, so that helps me out a great deal.
Let me just say I'm a West Philly native, been knowing the Wheels of Souls all my life. They represent a very positive influence in the neighborhood. They've always represented it, and man, let me tell you something, we think highly of them. They're a very good, positive force in the neighborhood. Thank you very much. Peace.
So everybody like the motorcycle.
My neighbors, Wheels of Soul, has helped us financially, community-wise, and patronizing the business.
Sometimes trouble, I call her. Help me.
She's saying if there's trouble and all, she just calls us and we give her a hand. That's it. English not that good, but she cooks real good.
Tonight, columnist Clark DeLeon takes us to West Philadelphia, where a rough, tough motorcycle gang is turning some heads with its active efforts to stamp out drug abuse.
Meet the Wheels of Soul, the most unlikely allies you would expect to find in Philadelphia's war on drugs, crime, and fear in the streets.
We're highly upset
about the way our villages are going. And right about now, our villages are, some of them are, they're in shambles. But we want people, when they walk by this clubhouse and look and see, say, well, you know what, maybe my kids should be over there, because maybe they got a better plan.
You know, kids respect us, and they want to be around us. And, you know, don't get me wrong, you know, some of us been in trouble. I've been in jail almost all my life, but, you know, we are the people that can give something back to these kids.
Man, these kids are wild today, man. You yeah. can't say nothing to them. These times have changed, man. You know what I mean? 8 to 50s.
If your kid's bringing home crazy money, and then you're sitting there accepting all the crap that he's buying with it, and then you're accepting that for right, then you're as wrong as the hell they are.
But you know, it's all a part of knowing who you are. And let's face it, if you don't know who you are, how can you teach your kids who they are?
They don't care shit about the kids in our neighborhood. No. They don't give a shit about the housing and the
not,
drugs that's going on.
It's not their kids, so they don't care.
It's not their kids, so they don't care. So I don't care about what you know, trying to convince them, you know, that they ain't got to be afraid of me. To hell with them. See, I don't care if they're scared of me or not. That's my opinion. And all of my brothers got my different opinions of that. Yeah. I care about the people that's in that area, in my area, that they know that they can look to us. You know,
things are shame all over, man. I mean, you know, you got these people out there, you know, that are watching this right now. What are you doing about the problem? What are you doing about it? You know what I mean? We're right here. What are you doing about it? Nothing.
After the first year, I became president. At first, I was Sergeant Arms, and then for the next 10 years after that, I was president. And after being president for 10 years, they decided to impeach me.
Where's the sound?
1967, my son and his bunch started the Wheel of Soul. I was proud of him when he started, and they've been going around building more and more. And everywhere they go, everybody said it was friendly bunch of boys. And so I've been proud of my son ever since he was born.
Like I told you, the club was started in the middle 60s, well, 67 to be exact. We, a lot of black clubs didn't understand us at all. They didn't know what was going on. They said we was looking and acting like white clubs and shit. And
it wasn't so much as we trying to act like any white club, man. It was like, now, I mean, we had white guys, Puerto Rican guys in the club that started the club. The whole thing about it was like, we were so unique, we were so fucking different. These cats didn't know how to accept us, and they didn't know how to deal with us.
They thought everything was a big laugh and a joke, and that they could be arguing and having a problem with my brother without having the problem with me, and that just wasn't the way things went with the Wheels. Just because we're outnumbered by a lot of them, 10 to 1, it didn't make no difference. Cause like they've been saying, we've been used to fighting and having and being outnumbered and getting shot and doing whatever else you had to do. So, you know, them just crowding around us didn't mean shit. Either they gonna do something or they ain't. And if they could do it, we right there. And if you leave any of us left, we could be right there again.
Bikers like to enjoy the machine. It's man and machine. That's our common denominator. It's the machine, the motorcycle. The numerator is each individual man on top of the machine. See?
One of the most beautiful things I've ever seen is to see all these brothers together in one place, and they gather, and there's so much love and enjoyment, and you see, I mean, we have babies that are growing from, like, in the womb to grow up in this culture. And it is a culture. It's a culture that is one of the oldest parts of black culture in this country.
We have a thing every year down at the end of the boardwalk in Atlantic City, and we stay on the beach. It's at the inlet, and one of the only places that they let us party all night long and stuff. We've never had any problems down there. But this year, the fire company, Atlantic City Fire Department, they were having a fun drive, they were trying to raise money for one of the charitable causes that they always try to do every year, and just happened to be a few hundred of us down there, and we said, we'll go down there to the boardwalk and donate whatever we can, and turn it into a pretty nice run and pretty nice party.
Let's give it up for the Wheels of Soul, everybody. Excellent job, my brother.
Hey,
thank you very much.
Absolutely, anytime.
Get out here amongst all the people, ride that bike, and do my thing. You know, and listen to roar that engine, listen to the brothers laugh and bullshit, and go, you know, drink beer and have a good time.
Really, people have bad images about bikers, but we're friendly if you just stop and talk to us and ask us anything you have to ask us. We're not mean, we're not gonna bite you anything. We're just here to help you if you need it.
With the women, they think that all women that belong to a motorcycle club, that we sleep with all the men in the club, and that's our initiation into the club. It's not even like that. It's all about family. I'm married, she's married, we're all married here, have husbands, families, jobs, homes. But just like everybody else, it's just we like to go out, get on a nice bike, get out in the wind, let our hair blow, and party and have a good time. It's all about family and respect.
We just about riding, having fun, and enjoying ourselves. That's what we're about. This right here, Sergeant Devon. How you doing? Yeah, look very nappy.
Okay. Right
here, right inside of here. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Dirty
Harry.
Right here, you got the Godfather with Tyrone, the enforcer.
Yeah.
I'm the Sergeant Devon from Chester Chapter. We're so 23 years.
We did a good run today for March of Dimes, Atlanta City Firefighters, and they was all happy about that, you know? It was a damn good run.
Ain't no party like a Wheels of Soul party. Wheels of Soul party don't stop. We heading on over to Bridgeton. We're gonna party all night long. Now, if you wanna see something live in the living color, come on over there, because I'm gonna tell it to you right. Whether you like us or dislike us, learn to love it. Because it's the best thing going today. Wheels!
Wheels!
If you love me like you said,
Wheels of Soul just don't let anybody in the club, you know. We've got people that we turn away every week trying to be Wheels of Soul. We don't want just anybody, you know. People who just come in just to throw the colors on, and then they realize what the real deal is, that this isn't just a lifestyle, man. You know, this encompasses all of us, man. This is my religion, this is my job, this is everything.
They hear Wheels of Soul and, you know, automatically think it's a black club. They're probably going to be depreciated, you know, because, you know, we're there. They didn't say because a biker club, be blacks. To hear people say this, you know, and nobody said nothing. Nobody says nothing like it.
It wasn't just a motorcycle club. It was the fact that they were black.
That we were black.
The property value.
And they sat right there in that meeting and made
right
statements
there,
like that. You know what I'm saying?
Come on, come on, come on.
we got here, we have fire department lined up all the way down Elm Street. They never even made it a crime scene. And the funny part about it, when we got here, as soon as we got here, I had a sergeant from the Bristol Police Department call me over, and he asked me, he said, do you think one of your members might have done this to win favoritism over the zoning board?
The bottom line is they want this off their back. And I guess they're gonna have to, they're pointing it at us. And because of the fact that I couldn't tell them who it was, that told them that there was a discrepancy in my story, and that's the best they got to go at. So they've charged me with conspiracy to conspire with somebody about the attempted arson and the cross burning here, and then hindering their investigation. So we're back at it with the city officials, and I will be vindicated, but looks like I'm gonna have to hire a lawyer.
You know, making a statement, do you think one of your guys done this? Right away, I'm under the impression that, you know, the investigation is over before it started.
You know, maybe these people got something to hide. I got no idea. Maybe there's somebody up there that's got interest in the property. That's a possibility. I got no idea. I wouldn't even want to be silly enough to suppose, because I don't know. But I do know there's an awful lot of heat. There's been an awful lot of heat on us for some fellas that they don't even know, because we've never dirtied up the neighborhood. Been here for 30 years. The club's been in this town for 30 years. And, you know, why all the heat? I got no idea, but I do know there's a lot of heat. I do know they offered me a deal to make this all go away. You know, if I signed a little piece of paper, they told them I had something to do with it. Why they picked on me, I got no idea, except that maybe they thought I'd cut and run. I don't know.
But when we got here, it was across here that they had set a fire. The grass was burned up here. And it was kind of, you know, funny, because they took and tore the cross apart. I would think the cross would be evidence. You know what I'm saying? But they took and took the cross apart before they even left here. They took it apart. And they took pictures of the building, but the pictures that they took, that they put in the paper, was go home. But if you look at the wall, it says go home niggas. I mean, but for whatever reasons, and from what I was told, the mayor didn't want the nigger part on there with the hate crime thing.
When I first saw the writing that was written on the walls in the newspaper, I was very disappointed, because in growing up and seeing what racism does and understanding it, I thought we were far beyond that. And I think it's a bad stigmatization, whether it's go home niggers or go home honkies or whatever the writing might be. I don't think that's the right approach to anything. Yes, it has brought a change to the community, because they didn't expect something like that to come about, because they're not doing anything wrong in the community, nor are they doing anything wrong to people. And because people don't understand, they do things like that.
This mayor, he made a statement in the paper that, you know, we wasn't going to be here. He wasn't going to allow us here. We wasn't going to be here. I mean, I don't know how he can say that when we've been here for 33 years and we're not going nowhere.
Some of the toys that we collected from some of the brothers, Latin Riders, Wheels, and what have you, all the brothers that's participating in this run for the kids.
Hey.
flames around here. And my wife is white. She and her family has it. So, and then they're going to come and tell you, you're going to tell me that you don't have them here? Go to Millville. And they'll tell you that they petitioned for them. But yet, it's funny that most of them got suits down. Now they don't realize what they were.
Okay, guys, I want to thank the Wheels of Soul for sharing their love with young children by bringing toys to this parish of Immaculate Conception, Roman Catholic Church. It's a great act of charity that they embark on to show that we are truly all one. Black, red, white, yellow, whatever we are all created by God. And we thank these guys for coming down here and sharing it with us.
What went down today, man, going by, you know, City Hall, going through the neighborhoods, man, we wanted to let them know that we're here. Like before, you know, in this town, Bridgeton, you know, we've been quiet for a while, but we're going to let them know, you know, we are here. We ain't leaving. This is our house. They can say what they want to say, but, you know, we don't care. This is our town. My people, they've been born and raised in here, and ain't nobody making us leave.
You spoke on the future. Gizmo couldn't speak on that since he's sitting there with the little future he's bringing up right there. That's his family.
2076, Nick might be a president. Tell him what your job is now.
Sergeant Lawrence.
And what are you?
Outlaw biker.
What do you ride?
A Harley Davidson.
What kind? What kind of Harley Davidson you got? How about you, Margaret? What about you got?
No.
What color is it? Who makes it?
Mine's black.
Who makes it?
Molly Davidson.
Hey, Nick. Tell a man. All right, hold on. Tell a man what you do with jet buttons.
No. Get that, man. Get that.
I'm not saying
in that one. Hey, good man. See the fist,
brother. We're trying to recruit young fellas like this, and he's really interested in the biker lifestyle. He likes it. Ever since he's been a little kid, you know, he's always wanted a motorcycle, and I wouldn't let him have a motorcycle, fearing that he would get hurt. And I still kind of fear he'd get hurt. I still take him as a baby. That's my baby. So we're trying to recruit young fellas like this. And
so watch out. This watch is the next generation.
That's the next generation.
We call these products of the Wheels of Soul. Wheels forever, forever wheels. God bless y'all.
We have a card that we had made up, you know, just for people like that lives on that street, you know, Elm Street. And you know, the card is what the card is, when we do good, no one's remember it. When we do wrong, no one forgets. And that's the, you know, that's the God's honest truth.
I just think that's the way society is. They fear anything they don't understand. But the only way you can understand is, and I'll invite anybody, hey, I drink Coke 45. Stop on by, we'll get a six pack, sit on the bench out there, and I'll talk your head off.
The love that we have for each other is unbelievable. The camaraderie is so strong that I'm willing to give my life for any of my brothers. I love my brothers. And I feel the same they would give their life for me also.
What I would do for my brothers? And what my brothers would do for me, just about anything. That describes, in general, just about anything. I would die for them as well as they would die for me.
To die a will is to live forever.
There you go, bro.
And I thank the brothers that's sitting here with me right now. It's no doubt in my mind that they live this, they breathe it, they eat it, they sleep it, and they'll live forever.
There's no greater honor in this world than living for what you believe in, dying for what you believe in. That's why I'm a wheel of soul forever.
Because it ain't nothing like this. It's unique in its own way. You know what I mean? And I'm not the smartest man. You know what I mean? But I know something about life. I know something about people. You hear me? I'm your friend until you show me something else. I love these brothers. I gotta cut it off, because I'm getting emotional.
Yeah, he gets long-winded on you.
It's such a shame. If you look at this group, and if you look at the world, and if you look at all the problems we have with race and this, that, and the other, until you get to know people and you find out we're all so much more alike than we are different. That's all the belly aching about.
And I always think of that Henry V speech where he says, you know, we few, we happy few, we band of brothers. For he who sheds his blood today with me shall be my brother. He who wears his tattoo today shall be my brother. It's a real thing, and I admire it greatly.
All right. May not be Boy Scouts, but they got America. No competition. Yeah.